journey along the Nile through Egypt's ancient lands is nearing the end. We are now 690 kilometers south of Alexandria and the Nile Delta. Our bus ride to Aswan's airport for the next leg of our journey is taking us across the Aswan Low Dam. From here we can see Little Lake Nasser, the site of the Temple of Isis and the island of Philae. And, in the distance, we can see the electricity pylons of the Aswan High Dam. On the other side of the bus, looking north, is the first cataract, and in the distance, the Nubian settlements. 6.5 kilometres upstream is the Russian-built Aswan High Dam. During the late 1950s, the then-president, Gamal Abdel Nasser, controversially chose Russian investment over the British and American offer of finance. The 3.8-kilometre-long embankment dam became a key objective for the government after the 1952 revolution and became pivotal to Egypt's industrialisation. It further regulated the annual river flooding, provided immense water storage for agriculture, and initially provided about 50% of Egypt's electricity needs. This has fallen to about 13% today, as Egypt's consumption has increased. Completed in 1976, the dam flooded a valley 550 kilometres long and 35 kilometres at its widest point. It penetrates 200 kilometres into the Sudan. It displaced more than 100,000 Nubian people and without UNESCO's rescue attempts could have submerged 14 ancient temples, monuments like this temple on a nearby peninsula. This is the tourist flight to Abu Simbel Airport. Passing over the Tropic of Cancer, we are flying 230 kilometres southwest to near the border with Sudan. From above, it is easy to see the enormous flooded area of the huge Lake Nasser. We are on our way to see perhaps the most famous of UNESCO's temple rescues, the Temple of Ramesses II. The Abu Simbel Airport isn't a dry desert. It may never rain in this part of the world, but there is certainly no shortage of water. As we saw in Aswan, there is no need to have roofs on the houses in this part of the country. The tiny township of Abu Simbel became an important staging post as Lake Nasser filled behind the newly constructed Aswan Dam. It became the centre of activity to save perhaps the most important of the ancient temples, the temples of Ramesses II and his devoted queen Nefertari. The moving of the temples was a huge task. The whole temple was cut into pieces, and in a central storage area, the blocks were carefully catalogued and filed like books in a library. Each block was given an identification number, so they knew where it had come from and where it was going. There was no room for error. In April 1966, the last pieces of Abu Simbel, including the pharaoh's enormous feet, were moved. As one temple was being demolished, another temple was taking shape. The biggest task was to rebuild the mountain around the temple. The solution was to build a huge concrete dome over the temple. The dome would bear the weight of the mountain and protect the delicate structures, paintings and reliefs inside. The reassembly of the temples took 19 months, and then all 10 kilometres of cuts had to be filled and disguised. On October 31st, 1968, 4.5 years after it was begun, the project was completed. Perhaps the most majestic of all Egyptian temples. The facade is dominated by four colossal 20-metre-high statues of Ramesses, perhaps the greatest of the pharaohs, with the breshent of Upper and Lower Egypt on his head. The missing head, dislodged in an ancient earthquake, can still be seen at the statue's feet, exactly where it was before the move. Across the top is a frieze of 22 baboons, worshippers of the sun, their arms raised in the air, the first to greet the rising sun each day. In a large niche above the entrance is the falcon-headed sun god Ra, with the sun disk on his head. On each side are reliefs of the pharaoh. Behind this facade is the dome structure taking the weight of the rock to protect the temple below. Next to the legs of the colossi, traditionally no higher than the pharaoh's knees, are his queen Nefertari, the queen mother Mut-Tui, his first two sons, and his first six daughters. Also saved from the water is the legacy of a not-so-ancient graffiti writer. About 100 metres northeast of the Temple of Ramesses, known also as the Small Temple, is the temple dedicated to Ramesses' favourite consort, Queen Nefertari, for the worship of the goddess Hathor. Only once before in ancient Egypt history was a temple dedicated to a queen. Usually the statues of Egyptian queens are only knee-high against their pharaohs, but here we see a 10.5-metre Ramesses on each side of the door, with the same size Nefertari next to him. This exception to such a long-standing rule bears witness to the special importance attached to his Nubian princess. It is said that Ramesses, who lived until the age of 94, had at least 40 wives and over 100 children, but Nefertari was by far his favourite. Inside the temple, the beautiful paintings and reliefs show Nefertari and Hathor. It may be small in size, but it is great in harmony. Costing $40 million in 1964 dollars, the reassembled temple and its famous facade, 665 metres higher and 220 metres back from the lake. The almost invisible joins in the facade are a tribute to the multinational team of archaeologists and engineers. Egyptologists say the temple was a storehouse for Ramesses' wealth, and also to commemorate his alleged victory at the Battle of Kadesh. Historians say it was also an attempt to intimidate his Nubian neighbours, and again, here they are under his feet. Through the entrance, we enter the 18-metre-long hypostyle hall, with its eight huge pillars of Ramesses as the god Osiris, the god of the underworld, indicating the everlasting nature of the pharaoh. Ramesses is seen here wearing the plashent of Upper and Lower Egypt. 65 metres from the entrance is the sanctuary, where four seated figures are carved from the sandstone rock. Ptah, the god of the underworld, Amun-Ra, the king of all gods, Ramesses, the king of Egypt, and the sun god Ra. The axis of the temple was positioned by the ancient Egyptian architects in a way that on October the 21st and February the 21st, allegedly the king's birthday and coronation day, the rays of the sun would penetrate the sanctuary and illuminate the sculptures on the back wall, all except for Ptah, the god of the underworld, who would always remain in the dark. The final rays of the sun would settle on the sun god Ra. If the archaeologists and engineers, with all their modern technology, have managed to duplicate the amazing calculations of the ancient architects, you are about to see a phenomenon that has happened for over 3,200 years.
Yeah. sunshine.